Women's studies is going through some turbulent times, and there is a sense that the discipline is under siege, especially with the rise of all forms of critiques that appeared to have gnawed away at what constitutes the core of women's studies, which is sex and gender. And while different critiques, such as third world feminism, queer theory, black feminism, and post-colonial theory, appear to be searching for a space beyond sex and gender, women's studies seems to be resisting this move and remains, it seems, quite firmly tethered to sex and gender. So in this talk, what I'm going to do is look at one distinct strand of feminist theory, that is post-colonial feminism, and the specific nature of its challenge to the way in which women's studies has been conceived and understood, especially within the context of the legal arena. And I'm going to address four aspects here. First, I will set out the assumptions on which women's studies are based. And here I focus much more on the features of women's studies in my own context, which is post-colonial India, which is closely linked to the women's movement, though it undoubtedly shares some common features with women's studies in the United States. Secondly, I look at some of the challenges posed to women's studies by specific movements, namely third world feminism, sexual and religious minorities, and question the relevance of women's studies once its exclusionary and non-revolutionary side is so thoroughly exposed. In the third part, I set out how the demise of women's studies, or its potential demise, is symptomatic of the waning tools of modernity and the specific challenges posed by post-colonial theory to the basic assumptions about the subject, history, and progress on which the liberal project is based, along which lines women's studies has largely continued to operate. And finally, I address what's left of this project of women's studies once it's been so thoroughly refashioned by post-colonial theory, and whether this in fact constitutes a rout of the project, or more interestingly, signifies the emergence of a new incarnation of the project. And I'll end with some remarks of what post-colonial feminism offers women's studies as an intellectually and politically productive project. Now, while women's studies centers have been a part of a global phenomenon, they have acquired their own distinct histories and identities within the historical and political context in which they were established. Within the context of post-colonial India, women's studies centers have not necessarily been a force for radical change, though they were, one could say, born out of the revolutionary zeal of the freedom movement. There was a sense at the time of the freedom movement that the country was taking charge of its own destiny, that it could break with its colonial past. And when the clock hands joined palms at the stroke of midnight on August 15, 1947, the vision of human freedom for millions who had been kept under colonial subjugation would indeed be realized. The stroke of midnight brought freedom from the colonial yoke as two nations tumbled forth into the world, but also produced perhaps one of the largest and most violent refugee movements in modern history. Yet, this context of freedom and anti-colonialism constituted the central features of women's activism and subsequently also of women's studies. The period immediately prior to independence was focused on the upliftment of women. This discourse drew heavily on a reconstructed identity of women as mothers of the nation, which was embedded in the idea of an Indian womanhood. The discourse of women's uplift was used to support demands for social and economic reforms to enable a greater public role for women. It was an argument that women's distinctive roles and values as self-sacrificing mothers and dutiful wives could make an important contribution to the public sphere. The discourse of uplift developed alongside the discourse of equality over the course of the 20th century. Women's groups began to focus on the idea that it could produce a world in which gender and sex would become history and no longer important markers of social difference. Equal rights discourse and its emphasis on achieving equality for women within economic, political, and familial spheres resulted in the passage of laws that guaranteed sex equality and special provisions for women in the areas of employment, politics, education, and some aspects of family law. And these efforts actually met with mixed results. The discursive struggle to constitute a legitimate political subjectivity for women in the public sphere was successful. Political representation and constitutional equality rights were indeed achieved. The discourse of equality of women as the same as men and entitled to the same treatment, however, sat in tension with the construction of women as different, the construction of Indian womanhood that formed the core of the women's movement, which distinguished Indian women from Western women. The women's movement has remained tied at one and the same time, then, to a revolutionary as well as a non-revolutionary sensibility. And it continues to invest in some notion of a distinct culture and Indian womanhood that remains inherently conservative and essentialist while pursuing this idea within the context of a revolutionary enterprise, that is, equality between men and women, and the end of gender and sex as markers of difference. Then in the 1980s, a new focus emerged on sexual violence against women in both the public and private spheres, especially a focus on rape. These campaigns tended to center women as victims, inviting legal responses that were in fact highly protectionist and justified by the government and the media who entered the debate as necessary to protect women's honor and chastity from violation. At the same time, the focus on the victim subject helped the women's movement retain its anti-Western nationalist credentials. Choice, especially in sexual matters, remained muted, for sex per se was regarded as foreign, a contaminant from which Indian culture and the Indian nation had to be protected. The legal campaigns then on rape met as well with mixed results. They did not transform the legal meaning of rape, displaced the problematic constructions of consent, nor the assumptions about women's sexuality. But they did make inroads into revealing the violence that women experienced and in condemning that violence. Yet the women's movement could not ultimately control the discourse within which that violence was condemned. Shame and dishonor continued to inform the popular and legal discourse on rape. The VOW campaigns, the Violence Against Women campaigns, and their focus on women's victimization have also formed, in fact, a central plank in the agenda of third world feminism as it's emerged from the South Asian context in the international arena, especially in the area of women's human rights. Third world feminism has consciously steered away from discussing or engaging with sexuality in the international context, and I'm talking about in the international UN human rights world, regarding the subject as a specific obsession of first world feminists. Now, the focus on the victim helped to consolidate the identity of third world women as distinct from Western women, and hence tended towards political conservatism. By invoking victim rhetoric, the feminists quite understandably have been trying to negotiate the complex terrain of needing to validate their nationalist credentials in order to have salience and not be cast as Western and hence irrelevant. While third world feminism has expanded the feminist horizon, it has been at times more inward looking. It's not a project that's propounding this new comprehensive political vision of society, nor has it expanded the feminist political vision. So this brings me to my second point, the challenge of women's studies from outside sources. The revolutionary spirit of women's studies has not only been challenged by its own internal contradictions, but it has also faced some serious challenges from the politics of religious and sexual identity. At one national women's studies conference back in the early 1990s, some feminist activists and scholars from the religious minority communities, Christian and Muslim, posed a challenge to the women's movement, declaring that the women's movement was Hindu-dominated and protected by this identity, especially in times of civil strife uncertainty and riots. Many feminists were nearly apoplectic over the suggestion that their secular credentials were being challenged by the sisterhood. Leftists were acutely disturbed. Yet these claims were made in a period shortly after the mobs of the Hindu right tore down a 16th century mosque with their bare hands, claiming that it was built precisely on the spot where the Hindu god Ram was born. Thereafter, there were riots in Bombay. The victory of the Hindu right in the national elections in 1999, and the slaughter of almost 2,000 Muslims during the riots in the western state of Gujarat in 2002, all of which highlighted the validity of these concerns. The women's movement, with its focus on gender and victimization and a universalized Indian women's identity, did not address these fractures and cleavages, apart from appealing to the discourse of secularism. Yet a mere appeal to the discourse of secularism as per se an effective counter to such movements, coupled with a refusal to engage with the politics of religion out of fear that their secular credentials would be tarnished, has proved seriously inadequate. Let me illustrate. After the 2002 riots that took place in Gujarat, the western state of India, reports indicated that the nature of the violence by the Hindu mobs against the Muslim women was particularly brutal and sadistic. While some feminists, including Martha Nussbaum, outside and inside India, cast this violence within the framework of universal objectification of women and the use of women's bodies as things and instruments, these arguments miss the broader ideological agenda and discursive elements of the right that have gone into constituting the subjectivities of both the majority as well as the minority community. The Hindu right has successfully appealed to liberal rights discourse and the discourse of secularism based on equal treatment of all religions, as well as equality as formal treatment or sameness in treatment, to call on Muslims to assimilate to the national red Hindu fold. Any resistance to this call immediately is cast as anti-national, anti-secular, posing a real threat to the identity and security of the Indian nation. It is this discursive strategy that has come to constitute the Muslim as unacceptable, as a foreigner, as oppressors of the majority community, and Muslim men as lustful and a threat to Hindu women. Hence, the violence on Muslims inflicted during these riots is justified as an act of self-defense on the part of Hindu women and the Hindu nation. You can find parallel arguments in this context, in this country. A position that universalizes women's experience and falls back on invocations of secularism cedes space for defining the role of religion in the public sphere to the right. It also fails to address how the meaning of secularism has been itself increasingly defined by the right. And again, this is something that's happening in this country, where you're seeing the wall steadily crumble, being replaced by an equal treatment of all religions concept. Another set of challenges to women's studies has come from controversies surrounding sex and the emergence of sexuality studies. In India, this contemporary challenge has been expressed in the legal contests over the screening of films such as The Bandit Queen, convulsions over the holding of beauty pageants. At one point, we were winning everything. The hip gyrations and pelvic thrusts in Bollywood cinema songs and dance sequences a la Chameli, the celebration of Valentine's Day, and protests over the emerging visibility of gays, lesbians, and sex workers. These contests all reflected a growing unease with the increasing publicity of sex and sexuality. The sexuality debates initially erupted over the screening of the film Fire, which I assume many of you are familiar with, by the Canadian diasporic filmmaker Deepa Mehta in the late 1990s. The story involves the attraction between two rather stunningly beautiful married women, Radha and Sita, who lived together in this joint family household, married to two distinctly unappealing and resistible men. Radha and Sita are both names derived from central female characters in Indian epics. In celluloid, they are reimagined in the contemporary moment to transgress nearly every sexual, familial, and cultural norm that constitutes India as it is imagined, including trespassing into an unacceptable sexual space. The movie culminates in what one reviewer curiously called or described as the Indian lesbian scene. The scene and the film triggered a national controversy over the cultural legitimacy of the film and its screening in India. While civil rights groups, including many feminists, regarded the banning of the film as a fundamental violation of free speech rights, the Hindu right read the film as an attempt to convert all women to lesbianism, which would lead to the demise of the Hindu family and Hindu culture. Gay and lesbian groups, in contrast, represented the issue as implicating the sexual rights of sexual minorities. And they argued that homosexuality had always been a part of Indian culture. They lobbied for the film to be a means for recognizing the rights to sexual identity and a catalyst to repeal legislation that discriminated against such preferences. And these groups emerged in opposition to feminist advocates who were cast as anti-pleasure and unwilling to engage in the politics of sexuality for fear of relinquishing the victim subject through which their distinct Indian brand of feminism had been constituted. The organized sex workers movement has posed similar challenges, especially to the nearly universal support by feminists for anti-trafficking laws and their specific focus on sex trafficking. These initiatives are invariably conflated with anti-sex work positions, deeply moralizing, and continue to constitute sex workers per se as victims. And they feed into an international representation of women from the developing or third world as sex workers, as is represented in the Oscar-winning documentary Born into Brothels, 2005. The discourse of sex workers has countered this representation at the material and normative level, asserting not only their sexual agency and choices, but also their complex subjectivity as mothers, as entertainers, migrants, consumers, and sex educators. While feminists were seen to be preoccupied, again, with violence or the goals of equality, others, in particular the sexual subalterns, argued there was no attention to sexual life or that it was attended to only through the discourse of violence. While I think there's truth, of course, in this critique in the context of India, I also have to argue that the proliferation of sexuality scholarship has not necessarily been revolutionary. It is not yet evident that sexuality studies have taken on board the need to challenge gender subordination and sexism while foregrounding the erotic body and sexual pleasure. The women's movement has been hemorrhaging from its internal contradiction as well as these external challenges. Together with other progressive groups, though, the women's movement is also experiencing a sense of loss and shared paralysis amongst those who believed in the revolutionary project, social transformation, and a world free of iniquities and social ills. So this brings me to my third point, and here I draw quite a bit on Wendy Brown's work. Identifying the source of this paralysis, though I do it through a post-colonial inquiry. What is it that seems to have died, and why? The gloom afflicting women's studies and the women's movement is in part framed by a despair over the waning tools of modernity and the flagging faith in liberalism as a coherent, progressive project for human emancipation. Post-colonial theory has argued that this non-revolutionary spirit is, in fact, constitutive of the liberal project. Let me focus on three aspects of this argument. The first is the idea that the downtrodden, including women, would be able to overthrow the forces of their subordination to take charge and become masters or mistresses of their own destiny. There is no doubt that this goal was indeed achieved at certain moments, for example, with the expulsion of the colonial power through the assertion of civil and political rights by colonial subjects, or the throwing off the yoke of slavery. Yet, what has replaced these challenges does not necessarily represent a triumph of the people and the goals of liberalism. Instead, at least in some countries throughout the world, we have witnessed the emergence of equally corrupt, illegitimate, and exploitative powers. And sex and gender have not necessarily been liberated in the course of these freedom movements, but remained embedded in cultural and gender stereotypes that constitute a part of the nation's identity. While India today stands on the brink of becoming a new global power, it is not because it has achieved the promise of revolution and freedom, nor does it stand as a beacon for the oppressed. While it is a country that does challenge Western dominance, and that's a good thing, it is the market that has liberated the entrepreneurial spirit of the people and given rise to the neoliberal citizen, a subject who is primarily a consumer rather than the bearer of rights or a victorious revolutionary. Secondly, we have seen a demise in the idea of history as progress. And post-colonial theory, as many of you are already familiar with, does unmask the view of history as this long, steady march towards progress, moving from a primitive into a civilized period. It exposes what Rushdie has called the chutnification of history, and how the view of history as progress emanated from the heart of Europe, ultimately serving the ambitions of the colonial enterprise and serving and justifying interventions into societies deemed primitive and backward. And that logic continues to operate in the present moment. The idea that we as a world have moved from some primitive past into a new modern era is further eviscerated in the contemporary moment by the emergence of reactionary right-wing movements throughout the world, not simply in non-democratic spaces, say Saudi Arabia or Afghanistan or Egypt, but in the heartland of the homeland. In liberal democracies, the Christian evangelicals over here, the Reform Party across the border, the Danish People's Party, Blockner Party in Switzerland, or BNP in Britain, and of course the Hindu right in India. All of these movements feed on the emerging global panics over the survival of national sovereignty, conservative sexual morality, and cultural cohesion. Thirdly, the argument around the subject. Postcolonial theory has exposed, again, how certain subjects have been excluded from the terms of liberalism, which justified the subjugation of the other. Remember, when law was introduced into the colonial world, it was not deemed to be or regarded as something that was emancipatory or revolutionary. Law was introduced to justify the exclusion, why certain benefits and rights should not be accorded to the native subject unless he or she had reached a certain stage of civilizational maturity. Indeed, when Europe was in the midst of its struggle for liberty, equality, and freedom, and there was an assumption that these ideas were universal, these ideas seemed to stumble and falter at the moment of their encounter with the unfamiliar, with women, blacks, and the colonial subject. And these values meet with some of the same difficulties today in their encounters with difference and unfamiliarity. For example, in the context of Muslims, homosexuals, sex workers, and migrants. Universality is always accompanied by what Denise Da Silva has evocatively described as the other side of universality. Now, in this last section of my talk, if this is indeed the condition we are in, we have to ask ourselves, where does that leave women's studies and its focus on sex and gender, let alone progressive politics more generally? Is feminist scholarship and activism simply reduced to the status of permanent hecklers to power, not ever able to imagine a transformative future? Postcolonial feminism moves beyond the terrain that is traditionally defined as women's studies, moving beyond discussions primarily of sex and gender. Yet having moved beyond, has it diluted, if not altogether demolished, the epicenter of women's studies, rendering it obsolete and irrelevant? Are women's studies, which was yesterday's revolutionary, today's new dinosaur, in light of these new incursions into the concepts that traditionally define the terrain? What is left of women's studies is perhaps not the right question. I think that the more important question is, what does postcolonial feminism offer to women's studies when it has moved beyond this focus of sex and gender? We would presumably want to move beyond and into a world which has traveled beyond sex and gender. Yet there is a deep reluctance to move away from the objects of our trade, to continue to appeal to it, to invest in it, and to encourage its expansion, as so much political hope has been invested in it. Knowing what we know has not necessarily led to us revisiting this project, but to continue to pursue it with what Brown calls a yes, I know, but politics. The critique is suspended out of concern that it will create anxiety and even nihilism. I suggest that postcolonial feminism offers a critical yet productive way out of this anxiety. Its critique of women's studies and the basic assumptions on which the liberal project stands should not be equated with pessimism. Questioning women's studies is not to side with patriarchy, pimps, or evil. It is to remove those rose-colored glasses or lenses through which we have viewed the project and to force us to ask some very serious questions. What happens when the faith in women's studies stands eroded, when its revolutionary zeal has diminished? Where does that leave us? It's better to confront these questions rather than to cling to tattered frameworks or keep reusing broken tools. We need to free our imaginations and know what is it that we need to look for now. Postcolonial feminism offers, I think, at least four important exercises. Firstly, to turn the gaze back on ourselves and ask, how have we been implicated at times in rather conservative pursuits of gender? How has our work reinforced difference, cultural and gender stereotypes, and produced or encouraged, again at times, antiquated responses from feminists, human rights groups, as well as governments? An honest and urgent self-critique is warranted rather than some self-laceration driven by guilt or despair or resignation to liberal reformism. Postcolonial feminism divests women's studies of this blessed status as per se a force for good and as progressive. It unmasks how women's studies and feminism can operate alongside hegemonic social and political powers. This does not, however, negate the worth of women's studies. It simply forces us to have an honest conversation with ourselves, as well as those who are allies in this field, about the dark side of this project. Secondly, we need to understand the situatedness of women's studies, that it operates in and through cultural and historical discourses that regulate, fashion, and construct gender. Gender is a site of power, and it can be used by all sides of the debate to advance specific agendas, historically to advance civilizational agendas, and in the contemporary moment to legitimate a new kind of imperial state action, such as the bombing of Afghanistan, particularly in the name of women's rights. Domestically, it's been used to resuscitate authentic versions of culture, to entrench the public-private divide where women are regarded as cultural preservers in the home, or to promote protectionist, sexually sanitizing responses to violence against women. And domestically, I mean in the context of India. It is this power in the hands of those who use gender that must be understood, not its ability or lack of ability to transform women's lives, or its potential to bring about change. Women's studies needs to come to terms with how gender is deeply implicated in power, and how, and hence how seizing the conditions that make gender as well as to escape gender are impossible. Thirdly, there needs to be a reorientation of women's studies scholarship globally. Women's studies scholarship and advocacy here and there have failed to adequately center and interrogate the colonial trappings and hegemonic underpinnings of this project. In my view, it's not only useful but critical for women's studies scholars and advocates to consciously draw on the experiences of the post-colonial world, in particular post-colonial feminism. This does not mean simply including third world feminist voices into the curriculum, but to seriously consider how post-colonial feminism upends the discipline, while still enabling a more productive conversation within the discipline. What is then required is a much more mindful engagement with scholarship that emanates from within the post-colonial context, to draw on that which is subversive, critical, and analytical, rather than merely descriptive and compatible with first world assumptions about third world women advocacy and scholarship. Clearly that is being done. This is just to reiterate, you know, how we need to sort of push this particular aspect much more forcefully and much more consciously. And the fourth and related exercise is perhaps the most challenging. To seriously look for and learn from other traditions for a new political vision. And let me be clear here. My proposal is not to do a holier-than-thou Bollywood jig here and to eulogize the values of non-Western feminism over Western feminism. Located partly in India, what is evident to me is that Indian feminists, with their focus on dowry victims, sexual harassment codes, criminal law, and anti-trafficking advocacy, have seriously hampered women's rights to free speech, migration, sexual and bodily integrity, and rights advocacy. And the advocacy by the right wing in favor of all of these issues has fully exposed how women's rights advocacy can indeed be counter-revolutionary. Postcolonial feminism is not merely another deconstructive move. It provides a bridge to and is grounded in the philosophical and intellectual traditions of the subcontinent that provides it with a metaphysical and ontological orientation that does not simply concede space to mere liberal reform. Unfortunately, the philosophical traditions, other than from the West, have invariably been regarded as exotic, as esoteric, or as rooted in religion, both here and there. This view fails to recognize the religious tone of intellectuals in Western traditions. For example, the focus of the work of many liberal feminist scholars don't consider the ways in which liberalism has been shaped by social, economic, or historical forces, including the role of the Christian church. The religious dimension of the argument is constantly muted, for the liberal project views itself as acultural or anti-cultural, culture invariably being associated with religion, and also with something that's pejorative or negative, and something that's displaced onto the third world. Such a position also fails to appreciate the very significant distinction that's made in non-Western traditions between philosophy and religion. Some of these traditions are immersed in systems of logic, inference, dialectics that can be traced to well before the Buddha, who, as you might know, was an agnostic, to Amartya Sen, a Nobel laureate in economics. And Sen traces the tradition of dialectics debate and even skepticism in the argumentative Indian, which he concludes illustrates two truths: that everything is open to question, and secondly, that Indians are a loquacious people, that we don't shut up. But I will in just a few minutes. Thus, not only do these traditions expose the ways in which the liberal project is saturated in culture, but also how culture is not necessarily a negative attribute and can be deeply philosophical and liberating. Now, while these traditions are in no way homogeneous, I will end briefly by postulating at least three different aspects they possess, which can help to resurrect a project in deep need of resuscitation. First, the critique of epistemology and metaphysics, the very basis from which knowledge proceeds, is an integral and not renegade feature of some of these traditions. Challenges to epistemological issues in the West have often been castigated as the ravings of the postmodern, post-enlightened intellectual. Let me be very clear. This level of inquiry existed well before the postmodernists became the nuisance. Secondly, postcolonial feminism does not think of history nor time in unilinear ways. Progress does not mean a march forward, but an exercise of going deeper. Such an exercise entails constant reflection, critique, and debate of the metaphysical grounds on which our arguments are based, without fear of nihilism resulting from such engagement. It is a pursuit of knowledge that locates the revolution within the subject, where transformation of the world lies within the transformation of oneself, of the self. Related to this proposal is a third distinction, which is the conception of the subject and women's agency outside of the limited framework of the liberal progressive imaginary. Other philosophical traditions allow for the possibility of understanding subjectivity and agency in less sanitized and more grounded ways than is permissible within the liberal universe. Feminists have conceived of the subject as either living under false consciousness and in need of rescue by the liberal savior, or have highlighted the performative or subversive aspects of the subject, even though she continues to be constituted in relation to hegemonic discourse. And let me sort of, at that point, because I still think that the subversive subject is an important challenge, and I think I want to just return a moment to Chameli here. Chameli is a Bombay sex worker, and the film is really the depiction of an encounter between a man called Aman Kapoor, who's a well-paid young investment consultant, and Chameli, who's a sex worker, and whose life is revealed through these highly orchestrated fictional narratives, which she keeps on sort of throwing at Aman, and all of them turn out to be untrue, but they're just meant to horrify him all the time. The two meet really fortuitously while taking shelter in the underbelly of Bombay's alleyways during a dark and stormy night, hence the wet sari. Chameli is looking for business, and the consultant is looking for a mechanic to repair his car that's broken down. But over the course of the night, he finds himself constantly challenged by the character of Chameli and also exposed to the sordid underworld of Bombay life. What's important is how the film operates also not only in terms of celluloid fantasy, but also at the symbolic, where Aman represents this well-intentioned liberal male who withdraws from any sexual overtures made by Chameli, but's horrified by her tales of exploitation and abuse. He's pure and untainted, the good, respectable man who is initially disgusted by this licentious street woman and initially disengages from her completely, but then also gets drawn in by her tales of woe and tragedy, a tragic victim who is in this trade as a result of unfortunate circumstances. But he's progressive and morally non-judgmental, and at times even wants to try and rescue her by offering her monetary compensation. Chameli, in contrast, is this very complex, layered sexual subject in a post-colonial setting. And with her stories of victimization and woe, deception, and violation of her rights, she really plays on the liberal narratives that imagine women in the sex industry specifically and third world women generally as invariably in situations of exploitation and abuse. And these narratives, of course, reinforce conservative sexuality and the view that these women are vulnerable. What Chameli does is she constantly anticipates and fully comprehends the liberal agenda of her middle class male visitor, and is able to create a product that conforms to this agenda and also brings her benefit. The liberal agenda which seeks this project is shared by Aman, as well as the client who pays out of charity, as well as the liberal activist and the scholar who humanize and try and civilize her through their strategies of rescue, rehabilitation, and reform. While Chimeli consciously and carefully represents herself as a conforming object in her narratives, she simultaneously negotiates this deconstructive move, which involves producing herself as this intricate, multifaceted, thinking subject, one who cannot be comprehended exclusively in liberal terms, humanized and civilized through the conferment of formal legal rights. And this move, I think, is a conscious manipulative subversion of sex and culture and law, which only a subject is capable of performing, not an object who is merely acted upon. So it is a very subversive character in this film. And I don't, therefore, sort of discard subversion, but I do want to move on to how we can think of other notions of subjectivity and agency which are not still confined within this in relation to hegemonic legal discourse or within the confines of a liberal universe. And here I want to refer to the work of Saba Mahmoud and others who point out that these responses of false consciousness or subversion are unable to adequately capture the agency that is exercised outside of the liberal progressive imaginary. There are philosophical traditions where the subject is not individuated but exists in relation to the other, and where her location, her sexuality, class, and race don't constitute her subjectivity. Instead, what's important is the relationship between her actions, identity, and performance with her inner disposition, her inner internal development. And I want to just dwell on this by my final three examples here. When a Muslim woman wears the veil, one feminist response addresses her exclusively as a victim of false consciousness and subordinated to masculine norms. Or her choice to wear the veil is read as an act of resistance to liberal norms and values and the project of assimilation. Both of these ways of reading the subject, however, miss out on how her choice is linked integrally to her inner emancipation and her way of being in the world that simply isn't captured within these bounds of the liberal imaginary. It's a choice that needs to be understood in terms of the relationship between external acts and the performance of the subject, that is, the wearing of the veil, with her inward disposition. A second example is captured by the story of Umrao Jan, who's a 19th century Bombay courtesan, who was a sex worker, but who also wrote deeply philosophical poetry. In contemporary feminist liberal discourse, again, she would be regarded as exclusively subordinated by male privilege, a truncated, thoroughly victimized subject. Or critical theorists would read her as a subversive sexual subject who challenges hegemonic sexual, cultural, and familial norms, a bit like Chimeli. Yet while Umrao Jan is a courtesan, she is also much more than that. She's a sensitive poet. She earns her money in the kota or the brothel and feeds herself through her work, but that's not what defines her. What defines her is her poetry. She is a seeker. She seeks an internal peace and an internal grounding through her poetry, which is both philosophical and reflective. Her performance as a sex worker is only that, a performance, but it is her poetry which provides her with the reflective space that connects her performance with her inner disposition. It's a space that is not driven by her profession, but her inner philosophical being. And then a slightly different third example includes the Hijra, or the eunuchs of South India. Every year on the full moon day in May, the eunuchs congregate in the South Indian state of Tamil Nadu before a deity called Iravan, who is the son of a warrior prince, to perform the ritual of marriage. They claim their status as the brides of Iravan. Now, while holding beauty pageants, seminars on their social and legal status, and discussions on health matters 2 or 3 days before the full moon event, it's the marriage that is the act of supreme power and significance. The event is deeply ritualistic and a fervent moment. We're a bit like the dervishes. They work themselves into a frenzied and altered state of consciousness. It's a space which is freed from all those references that govern most aspects of their ordinary lives. The hijra, or the eunuch subjectivity and agency, is not defined by her sexuality, but by this more ritualistic, frenzied relationship. Now, all of these episodes, these spaces of subjectivity and agency, cannot be captured purely within the liberal framework. They're embedded in a metaphysical space that enables such complexity and the articulation of the self, not exclusively as victimized, nor simply in terms of performance as a eunuch, sex worker, or veiled woman. Agency is located in the relationship between these identities and performances to her interior disposition. Her subjectivity is not just an abject or excluded subject, but in fact is potentially liberating. It's a move away from all that is known into a state of very quiet stillness, where there is complete acceptance, where you are neither a victim, agent, nor subversive, but freed and liberated, not in the way the liberal imaginary conceives of liberation. These are philosophical spaces constituted by much more than one's performance or identity. They are constituted by what the subject is, and this isness is derived from a much more complicated space. This requires further elaboration, but it does allow us to have a much more layered, deeper, completely different way of thinking about how we can conceive of subjectivity and agency. While all of these ingredients need to be further elaborated, they do, in my view, provide the basis of newly imagining a political ground between despair and paralysis on the one hand and surrender to liberal reform on the other. So I want to end by restating that my critique here is intended to be productive and articulate a different cosmology within which to understand the place of women's studies and feminism in our contemporary world. To remain invested in the objects of women's studies, that is sex and gender, is to move away from the possibility of revolution. Yet as I've indicated, we cannot simply emancipate women's studies from its objects, as these objects are so deeply embedded in the subterranean pathways of power. So perhaps we cannot think in terms of revolution. We can, however, think in terms of transformation through a deeper and significant engagement with knowledge, its metaphysical location, and its goal, which is not reduced simply to a movement forward. The centering of excluded knowledges, excluded subjects, excluded histories can bring the project of women's studies back to a space, perhaps, of greater optimism and less despair. And this may also free us from the revolutionary paradigm without resigning to the liberal reform project. Ultimately, it is an effort to put life back into a project in desperate need of resuscitation and to help stage the sorely needed intellectual insurrection in the area of women's studies and progressive scholarship to open up the possibility to live and to think differently.